I want everybody to understand what's happening right now in the spirit. When Nathaniel began to cry out, roar, and we began to cry with him, we were honestly a little bit timid. But as we grew and as we continued to grow, I saw the Lion of the tribe of Judah coming out of heaven and looking, and he was watching. And as we grew and as Nathaniel began to go into roar and strike, I began to see the Lion stepping forward, moving forward, coming forward to move across this land. So we need to understand that the sound we are releasing is welcoming him. We are aligning heaven and earth together, and we need to move forward with roar.
So they did a study as to why a lion roars, and I think this is very important. They said that a lion will roar, first of all, over his pride, the lion's family. And when he's roaring, he's signifying, these belong to me. These are mine. The second reason that he roars is he roars over his territory. And as he's roaring over his territory, he's saying, this belongs to me. The third reason that he roars is to say, every intruder, every rogue lion, every interloper, every enemy, you better back off. Now, I want to tie this in to the vision that I shared with you about the Lion of Judah roaring over our nation. And if ever we need the lion to roar over the United States of America, it's right now. How many believe the Lion of Judah can roar over the city of Atlanta? The Lion of Judah can roar over the Washington, D.C. and New York City. And the enemy may have called for a night of rage, but I'm telling you, the Lion of the tribe of Judah is rising over this nation. Jesus is roaring over this nation. He's saying, this all belongs to me. This all belongs to me. And so I want us to release a sound tonight, a sound of the roar of the lion, a sound of war, a sound of anointing that destroys the yoke. And I gave you a scripture last night. Joel chapter 3 verse 16 says, the Lord shall roar from Zion and utter his voice from before Jerusalem. The heavens and the earth will shake. How many know that as many celebrations as we have, this is a time of shaking in this land. But the promise is the Lord will be a protection, a shelter for his people and the strength of Israel. So can we begin to release the roar? Can we begin to release a shout? Can we release a sound in the spirit tonight? On the count of three, one, two, three. Roar! Roar! Come on, roar over America! Roar! 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 Roar!
What the Lord is showing me right now is that the lion and his pride are roaming to go out and destroy and devour. It is time for the hunt. As Jane was up here, I saw a large paw being raised up. And the Lord said, I need you to raise your paw, Tom, because you and I, all of us, are tied together. And when it's time to go and hunt, it's not just about the roar, which will give the message that the victory is about there, but I am ready to devour the enemy as well. So raise up your paws and say, Lord, we are here on the hunt, and we will not let the enemy do any more devouring. We are the ones who will devour the enemy in your name.
Lord, we declare right now, Father, that the heavens are open tonight. Isaiah 45 verse 8 declares that when the heavens are open, the earth must open. So we declare tonight, Lord, that we're not satisfied only to have an open heaven. But Lord, we speak to the earth. We speak, Lord, to Atlanta. We speak to Georgia. We speak to every state in the United States of America. We speak to Washington, D.C. and New York City and Philadelphia. And we say, hear the word of the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord. The God of peace is rising. The God of peace is rising. We declare the word of the Lord over America right now. That the God of peace is rising over America. The God of peace would rise and crush Satan underneath his feet. We decree the God of peace is rising and crushing Satan underneath his feet. We decree protection, God, over this land that we love. And Lord, we decree America shall be saved. And we declare that America will be a light to other nations. And that America shall fulfill her destiny. And that what took place here today, Lord, in a monumental decision, God, would have as far-reaching effects as the bad decisions have had in the past. Jesus, we love you.
Yes, we do.
We thank you, Lord, that you've heard every prayer we've prayed. And Lord, that the ecclesia is ready for the days that are at hand. Just lift your hands up all over this place, Lord. We submit ourselves to you. And if we're not ready, say, Lord, make us ready. Make us ready, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, we say, roar, Lion of Judah. Roar over this nation, Lion of Judah. Roar and show your power, Lord. In Jesus' name. Can we clap our hands to the Lion of Judah? Can we bless him tonight? Man, this worship team, y'all are off the charts. Okay. We're gonna how many are just so ready to hear the word tonight? Amen. Man, that worship just prepared the way. We're going to take a moment and we're going to receive this evening's offering. Amen. I believe that this is as strategic of a part of what's taking place tonight. And it was really interesting because Apostle Jackie came to me in the worship time and she said, would you mind receiving the offering tonight? And I said, sure. And so I just prayed for just a minute to ask the Lord what he wanted me to share. And, you know, the Lord just brought to my mind that we talked last night and this morning about the overthrow of the decree of Haman, the son of Hammedatha. And Hammedatha means double. And in his case, it ended up meaning double wickedness. But how many believe that God wants to release a double portion upon his church in this season of time? I believe that we've got to be ready for all that's coming. And listen, God's going to release a double portion. This is not, don't just think money, please. It's the spirit of wisdom and it's the spirit of revelation. It is the celebration of the victories that we won today and yet a preparation for what is to come to fight for our future. That's a double portion, amen? It is contending and blessing. How many are contending for blessing? Okay, but we've got to learn how to contend for this nation. And so tonight is an offering where we're contending and we're blessing. We're opening the heavens. We're opening the earth. And we are believing God for a double portion. Now, I mentioned, I think it was last night or this morning, that we're in the year 5782. And the 82 part of that year, if you look up the phrase double portion, it means double pay. How many know we're in the decade of the pay, the decade of the mouth, the decrees that we're making? And so I believe that when we are releasing things today, we need to understand there's power on our words. And we need to understand that when we sow a seed, our money speaks. How many know somebody said money talks? Come on. So when we're sowing a seed tonight, we're sowing into today's victory and in tomorrow's victory. Come on, because tonight is just the beginning. Tonight is just the beginning. Today is just the beginning. And so when we press into this place of double portion, we are overthrowing double wickedness. And so here's the scripture the Lord gave to me. Isaiah 61, 7. We all know it. For your shame, you will receive double honor. Come on, Ecclesia, listen to this. For your shame, you'll receive double honor. And instead of your confusion, you will rejoice in your portion. In your land. Come on, this is key. In the United States of America, you will possess double. Come on, guys. In America, we will possess double. In America, we will possess double. And everlasting joy shall be yours. Amen. I want to show you. Do we have that clip? I want to set this clip up. Okay, hang on just a second. We went and we prayed over a business, and we decreed a double portion. The same way I'm going to decree this over you. And I want to show you this amazing sign that the Lord gave to this business. And I just think it's going to speak to all of us about what God's getting ready to do. The company is Ancient Nutrition. You might know it. Josh Axe, Jordan Rubin. How many of you know Ancient Nutrition? They actually called a company of prophets to come in and prophesy to their business. Come on, how many think God can't help but bless that? And while Tom and I were there, we decreed a double portion over their blessing. And this began to happen the very next week. Now, let me see if we can get this to play. There's sound to it, so if you could crank the sound up, go ahead and play it.
Primarily because of the yolk. Now I'm showing you these.
All right.
This is a very unique miracle video. What you're looking at are six duck eggs. We've been consuming duck eggs for 3 years. They are super nutrient dense. In fact, they have as much as 8 times the vitamin B12 of chicken eggs. They have more of almost every nutrient, primarily because of the yolk. Now I'm showing you these duck eggs for a reason. Over the last 3 years, I've estimated that I've cracked 8,000 duck eggs. And all that time, I have witnessed one double yolk, where you have one egg with two yolks in it. There's a 1 in 1,000 chance of having a double yolk in a chicken egg. I think a duck egg, the odds are even greater. What you are witnessing is 6 eggs from a dozen. The first 6 eggs each produced a double yolk. The odds of 1 dozen eggs each containing a double yolk is 1,000 trillion. So 1 in 1,000 trillion odds of getting 12 eggs in a row with double yolks. Watch and see what we've got here. Now, what's miraculous about this is I'm believing that these double yolks symbolize a double portion of the anointing. So I'm gonna go ahead and separate these eggs. I don't know what's in here, obviously, but I'm believing that this is gonna be another double yolk, and it is. So this is the 7th in a row from this dozen. See how there are 2 yolks fused together? I'm separating them. There you see a double yolk. This would be number 8. And it's another double yolk. I'm literally blown away. 1 out of 1,000 chance to get 1 double yolk. In 8,000 duck eggs that I've cracked, I have seen in the last 3 years, 1 double yolk. Right there, that's 2. And this really represents 8. Watch this. I just believe it's going to be another double. And it is. So we are literally seeing something that's probably now incalculable in terms of how rare. You can see them all in this one bowl. And that one's even separated. This is literally representing, I believe, a double portion of anointing. Here's another one, and I'm taking it for granted now. I just literally have faith that every egg I crack is gonna be a double yolk. Again, I'm trying to separate these. I'm using the egg yolks for a recipe. There you go. You can see 2, 4, 6, 8. 8 yolks from 4 eggs. Here's another one. 1 out of 1,000 chance and another double yolk. I am literally blown away here. This is absolutely amazing. This is probably defying almost every odd you can think of. This is it. This will be 1,000 trillion if this is a double yolk, and it is. Look at that. Two completely separate yolks from one egg. I don't know what else to say other than that was six eggs. Those are 12 egg yolks. And as I told you, the previous six eggs from this very dozen were each double yolks. That is 12 eggs in a row from a full dozen with 24 yolks.
So the rest of the story is that they went on, and over the next week and a half, they cracked 144 double yolk eggs. 12 times 12 double yolk eggs. Do you think God is putting a giant exclamation point on some things today? Let me tell you what, God's in the business of doing things that are incalculable and impossible. And I believe that God is showing up and showing off in this season of time. So if that doesn't inspire you to give, if that doesn't inspire you to partner with God during this season of time, I don't know what will. So I want to encourage you to sow tonight. There's ushers in the aisles with envelopes. We're going to put something up on the screen to show you how to give electronically. You can, do we have that up? There you go. Those of you that are watching online, we want to encourage you to partner with us as well. I believe that we are coming into a double portion season, amen? And I believe that regardless of what's shaking, regardless of what's happening, God is on his throne and God is determined to see his ecclesia rise, amen? And so enter into this season and receive your double portion tonight.
Just lift up a praise to our King. What an incredible God we serve. What mercy, what grace, what glory, what power. An amazing God we serve. We're going to get Dutch up here. Thank you, team. Thank you, Nathaniel. And I, they warred through a lot of sound issues, but you warred through. And I'm with Jane, Nathaniel. In my spirit, man, I could do what you did, but if I tried to do that in my body, it would be really sad. Something would be broken and it would definitely be hurting. Before I get Dutch up here, I shared last night that sometime today I was going to give y'all the story about us moving in here. And then Jane admonished us, I think it was Jane, somebody, about we haven't been spending the favor God's giving us. We'll see if I can do this without crying. I mentioned last night that we had gone through a $400,000 lawsuit, and that was back in 2014. And God brought us through in a miraculous way. We were sued on Good Friday. We got an answer and got out of it by Pentecost. That's a miracle. And we finally, after wandering around trying to find a home, we landed across the parking lot on the other side. And we had a great space. And the company next door, I want you to hear, I'm telling this because I want you to hear the power of your mouth. The company next door, the guy who runs that office, knocked on our door one day and he said, "We need to expand. And we'd like to have the first section, which was about 5,000 square feet." But the problem with that was it was our counseling rooms, our bookstore. Most importantly, it was our sanctuary. And I said, "It's not happening." He said, "Well, you could move to the other side of your space. Y'all don't like your movie." I said, "We're here on the weekends, not on weekdays." He said, "Well, we really need it." And I said, "Okay." He said, he finally looked at me after I walked him through the whole building because he asked to see it all, and he said, "Well, tell me, what would it take for us to get your space?" This had to be the Spirit of God because I'm not this fast, okay? I looked at him and I said, "You get me a space that we don't have to move far because it took us too long to get here, and moving a church into a new space is difficult. That I end up with the same amount of square footage are better, and it's laid out better than we had, and the build out will be done. And my final thing is that my square footage rate that I pay is not going to go up. I thought, you know, I'm putting the bar way up here, right? So last January, the landlord called me up, and he said, I have a proposal for you. He said, we really need this space. And I'm thinking, okay, I've heard this before. He said, we have a proposal that if you will agree, we will move you across the parking lot. Close by, right? You can have the same square footage, less square footage, or more, depending on how you have come through COVID. And we will keep your square footage price per square foot rate the same as it was in 2016. And we will do the entire build out for you. You tell us how you want it designed, and we will do it, everything included. Let me tell you something. We got the same square footage rate. We got 5,000 more square foot. They tried to charge me more for the additional square foot, 5,000, and I said, you told me the same. And they gave it to me. They put $700,000 into this build out for us. Double portion. And they came back to me when they were, I got the paperwork, and it was only for 3 years. And I said, I called up our landlord. I said, what are you thinking? Because we've gotten to be buddies through all of this, right? And he said, well, that was kind of the remainder of the lease you had. I said, yeah, but do you think I want to go through this for 3 years? He said, what do you want? I said, 10. We got 10 years. Favor. And I will tell you, I said, and what I want written in is I want first right of refusal on the rest of the building. See, because where there's a vision, you have to cast it. You have to stand with it. We have words over this house that people are lined up in the parking lot to get in. Now, I'm going to tell you, I'm not about numbers. It's not my deal. But I am about maximum impact into a community that brings awakening and reformation that is measurable and sustainable. And we're going to have to learn how to speak the vision God has put in our mouth. And I'm going to tell you, the vision for this house, I heard out of Dutch Sheets in 2005. You may not even know this. You were at Glory of Zion for starting the year off right. I think we were in the dome thing over at University of Texas, North, whatever it was, the pit. And you said, I see rising up across the nation apostolic centers with congregations attached. And it hit my spirit like a lightning bolt. And I thought, well, I'll be a part of one of those someday. About 9 months later, I was in a meeting with Lance Wallnow, and he said, it may have been a couple of years after that. I'm trying to remember timeline. But it was a couple of years later. I was in a Lance Wallnow meeting. And he said, turn to the people next to you and tell them, oh, it was 2005, I'm sorry, I'm trying to get this straight. Tell them where you will be and what you will be doing in 5 years. I looked at him and I said, I'll be leading an apostolic training center with a congregation attached. And then he said, turn to the next person, tell it to them with conviction. He had us do this like 5 or 7 times. And by the end of it, I believed it. I didn't know what it would look like. I ended up in actually going, Joel, who was up here on the electric, he said, come on staff with me at the church that I've planted. Bring the apostolic. And I thought that was God's plan. And it was good for me to do that with him. But then the day came where God said, no, I told you to do it. So Dutch, thank you for releasing that word. Because I would have never in a million years, as a woman in Atlanta, coming up out of a Baptist background, would have never dreamed. And I look at all of you and I look at this building. And it's not about the building, but it's about God's favor. It's about God's provision. It's about God saying, I will do what I put on the inside of you if you'll simply trust me and walk one day at a time, not giving up, being filled with tenacity and perseverance. And when you get knocked down, and believe me, I've been knocked down a few times, even in the last few months, pull back into the place of privacy and silence and secret with me. Let me rebuild your faith. Let me refuel you with my spirit. And then get up again. And keep going. Let your forehead be set like flint and keep speaking what I tell you to speak. And I'm telling you, without these folks on this front row and a whole bunch of others that we run with, we couldn't do this. But I want to say thank you, Clay, Tom, Jane, David, Dutch. Thank you. First time I met you in 2003 at the 50 State Tour, I remember saying, I can run with that man because I love his heart and his passion for this nation. It ignited me right away. And it was a time when I was running with you and with Chuck, still running with Chuck, and I'm just going to give y'all this really, really quick. Chuck Pierce is going to be here on November 4th. He's coming to do a gathering right here. And so put it on your calendars. I know that's a ways off, but November will be here before we turn around really good. And I believe there will be a word of the Lord that's the Friday night before the election. The timing could only be set by Holy Spirit. We've got a lot going on between now and then, but you can see all of that on our website. I don't want to take the time for that. But thank you for being here. Thank you for joining your faith. Dutch, if you'll come, we want to hear the word of the Lord from Dutch Sheets. Amen. Amen.
It seems to be working. It doesn't, then we'll share it.
Thank you. Thank you. This place is just awesome. Thank you for sharing that testimony with us. I just love it. It's awesome. Was it twice the size or more than twice, that sanctuary? More than twice in here. Wow. I don't ever want to negotiate with you. I'll tell you that right now. Not even going to go there. And I heard the meeting was okay. Jane's been okay. Pretty good. Tom said pretty good. For a woman. Yeah. You have to understand. Touche. You have to understand, some of us came out of backgrounds that didn't believe in these ladies doing what they're doing. And of course, that's been a long time since that was our theology, but that's the way I was raised. And I still, you know, when they started doing it, I just thought, well, I don't know if that's right or not. And then when I realized the anointing and recognized what God was doing, I thought, well, I don't quite understand how that's working, but can't really deny what's happening. Oh, we've come a long way, haven't we?
I just say I'm a submitted wife and I'm doing what my husband told me to do.
Oh. Well, you have a great one, that's for sure. She has a great husband, that is for sure, and father-in-law, and I don't know her mom and dad, but I'm sure they're awesome too. Thank you all for being here. It's good together on this amazing day, and see what the Lord's doing. Amen. It's quite a day. So what I'm going to do tonight was I decided during the worship. So I'm going to have to just slowly move through this and let the Holy Spirit lead me while I do it. And he will. And I believe he's going to give prophetic insight even during this message, some from me, some from the others, who they can come up when they get it if they want, but certainly I'll give opportunity at the end for them to come up and jump into this. And he reminded me of a dream. I don't normally hold a mic. I normally have one of these ear things on. So have I got it right where it needs to be? Is this good? And I'll try to keep it right here. All right. But he reminded me of a dream that I haven't thought of in quite some time. And the more that I read through it during the worship, the more I came to a confidence that this is where he wants us to go tonight. So we'll just see how that ends up, what that looks like. But if you follow me on the 15s, you will have heard this. But I knew as I dissected this dream initially that more understanding would have to come later. And you'll see why as we progress. But in fact, I'll just tell you that part of it now, because it's a dream about a baseball game. And in the dream, it was called the World Seers Series. S-E-E-R-S, seer, as in prophet, World Seers Series. And you'll see all this in the dream as we go through it, but it's the kingdom of God, it's the church playing in this baseball game, the powers of darkness. Kingdom of darkness, kingdom of light. We're in the final game of the series for the championship. But the part that struck me as really interesting and significant is that when I gave this dream to Jane to look at, and I did that because she's in it, so I thought, well, I should let her weigh in on what she thinks this means. And she told me, I think there are four batters because it's the four quarters of the year. Do we have to change? Yeah. Sounded good to me. Oh, it's breaking up out there. They're going to get it on. Yeah, I feel like I'm going back in time with this corded mic. And they start singing some gospel song, don't I? Will there be any stars in my crown? Okay. She said, and I felt immediately that this was right. She said, I think the four batters represent the four quarters of 2022. And we'll see in a minute what, as I start breaking down the dream, we'll see what we felt like needed to happen in the second quarter, which we are just finishing. And it happened. With a week to spare. And so I think we're moving into the next phase. And we'll look at all of them. Okay, so that's kind of the big picture. And I can't believe I hadn't thought about this dream for probably 3 or 4 months. The dream was given to Greg Hood on January 2nd, so it was the beginning of the year. He says, as the dream started, I could see that we were in a baseball stadium. I knew we were playing on our home field, which in the dream was known as Royal Stadium. So it's obviously the kingdom of God. It's the kingly ecclesia, the Royal Stadium. And I knew that the stadium was located in Washington, D.C. So it was obviously going to be a dream about the nation, about probably, as it turns out, yes, a war for the nation. All the seats in the stadium were filled with people. I knew the people in the seats were mostly Americans. A smaller portion of people were from somewhere else, but that told me this is about America. This dream is not so much about the nations, but this nation. The attendees were there to watch what we knew was the World Seers series. Dutch and I coached one of the teams. Our team consisted of, and he gives some folks here that I don't need to go into. It was the final game in the series, and we were ahead. It was our turn to bat. Dutch was the head coach. He wrote out a new batting order and hung it in our dugout for the team to see. The atmosphere in the dugout changed somewhat, with some thinking that the old batting order was better than the order Dutch had rewritten. So there was a change of strategy this year. Very specific assignments were going to come, and it was a change of strategy, and it was a little bit unsettling to some, thinking, well, you know, the way things were working, the old batting order was fine. Ever heard that before? We had home field advantage. It was the bottom of the eighth inning, and we were winning. The score was 20-22. So we came to understand that the dream was about 2022. The contest, the war between the powers of darkness and light. This was for all the marbles. This was winner take all. I could see clearly on the scoreboard our team name, and the team name was Kingdom Ecclesia. I couldn't make out the name of the opposing team. The name was blurry. As it should be. Whoever said that, yeah. The mood shifted in our dugout as our team made an effort to encourage one another. We knew we were in the last innings of this game, and the game was tight. We didn't take anything for granted now. We focused intensely. We were the underdog, it seemed, and there was great urgency to win the game for the nation. I shouted a man's name. I won't tell you his name. And I said, so-and-so, lead us off. That's baseball terminology. You're the first batter. You're the leadoff batter. Lead us off. This man stepped from the dugout to go to home plate. And I will tell you this. This is important. He was a charismatic pastor, but from an evangelical denomination. Okay. He still to this day is a member of this denomination, but is openly, and the denomination is not a Pentecostal or charismatic group. They, as an organization, would not agree with the practice of the gifts of the Spirit and the baptism of the Holy Spirit as I would believe in it, with speaking in tongues and the things that I believe come with that, the gifts, etc. But they have never kicked him out, which is unusual. They've allowed him to remain, knowing, because he's influential enough, his church is influential enough, that he's not hidden, maybe in a small town with a small church of 50 or 100 people, and nobody really knows what he's doing. They all know what he's doing and who he is, but they've allowed him to remain. So he represented to me a stream of the church that is not charismatic, and a stream, since I won't tell you the stream, Lord, help me not to say the name of it. I would have to say a group that I believe is controlled to a great degree by a religious spirit. But he was going to be the first to bat. Okay. So as he went to home plate, we said to him, the ball needs to be hit straight down the first base line with great force. Your assignment is to remove the hindrance that's guarding first base. We got to get to first base. You can't get to first base, you can't score. As he walked toward home plate to bat, I saw the number on his jersey, 5221. 5221. In Strong's, that is the number for a word that means to meet or encounter, which is one of the definitions of intercession. The Hebrew word 5221 means to smite. To smite. He stepped into the batter's box and the pitcher threw him a curve. He hit it so hard down the first base line that the first baseman couldn't even see it coming. It struck him on the side of the neck and decapitated him. Now we're talking about a spirit here, okay, so you know, we're not talking about hurting people. This is a spirit. He represented a spirit. Just want you to know that. Anger was very evident on the opposing team because they now had no first baseman. So let me just quickly say, because of another dream that came toward the end of last year,
we knew that one of the first assignments for this year, and we didn't put it together with this dream at first, but we know one of the first assignments God was giving us at the end of last year and moving into this year was dealing with cutting off the religious spirit that was controlling America. He showed us a dream where we were going to the root of that religious spirit, and we went to several places in the nation in the dream and drilled down and cut off that control of that spirit and made our way to Washington, D.C., where we dealt with the root. And so Tom led, and I think Clay was a part of most of it, several people in a team called the 601 team, because in the dream, the number of the drill bit we used was 601, which is the number of revelation. So it was revelation, the spirit of revelation, that was going to take out the spirit of religion. So after they went to several cities, I joined them, and a group of us went to Washington, D.C. to deal the final death blow to that controlling strongman of religion over America that was keeping people blinded to Holy Spirit, to the power of Holy Spirit, to intimacy with the Lord, because a religious spirit does a lot of things, but one of the things a religious spirit does is brings a form without power. And a name that you're alive, but you're dead, it removes intimacy, it removes power. A religious spirit is going to do everything that spirit can to shut down any connection with Holy Spirit. So we went and dealt with that, and we knew that the first base assignment, the first quarter assignment, and we did this in February, on 2/22/22, you know it had to be anointed. We went to D.C. and took the head off of the religious spirit, keeping millions of people bound in a system. And the people are not the problem. And we don't dislike the organizations. But any spirit involved, the spirit of religion involved, that was keeping people blinded to the power of the Holy Spirit, we broke the hold of that strong man over America. And we are confident, right? We are confident that that was Jackie, you were there. Were you there with us? No. We are confident that we got to first base. That we took out that spirit and accomplished what we needed to accomplish in the first quarter. So, just keep reading now. The umpire at first base held him on first and wouldn't allow him to advance. So, as you're going to see as I read this, the umpires were cheating for the bad guys. So Ken Malone, friend of ours in Florida, was coaching first base and began to speak to the batter who was on first base now, or the runner on first base. Said, "Watch the third base coach, for he'll give you the steal sign telling you when to steal second." Coaching third base was the Archangel Gabriel. Gabriel, I would say, maybe some of these guys would add to this, but I would say primarily Gabriel's assignment is to be the messenger angel and over the messaging system of heaven, under Holy Spirit, of course. Then I said, and I'll give you this name, the second batter, since he's already been mentioned tonight. I said, "All right, Walnow, you're up." So now we're moving into the second quarter. not the quarter of a football game, quarter of the year, pictured to us by the second batter. I said, we need advancement. You know the pitch you're looking for. Wait for your pitch. Lance said to me in the dream, I feel confident. Now, this is not about Lance. This is about who and what Lance represents. Which, by the way, he represents probably different things we could come up with. But for me, Lance represents the Seven Mountain Movement. I'm going to reword that and say, to me, he represents the ecclesia getting out of the four walls and becoming the ecclesia and all of the mountains of culture, all of society. Bishop Hammond calls it the Saints Movement. Because it's when we moved into enough understanding that all the work of ministry is not supposed to just come from here, that we're all called and anointed to represent him. We all can do the work of ministry for the Lord. And so that's, to me, that's what the Seven Mountain Movement is all about. Let's be who we are out there in the culture and in society. And that's, although Lance is not limited to being able to teach on that, that's what I believe was the most significant thing about him being this second batter representing the second 3 months of the year. He said, I feel a confidence that I've never felt before. The pitcher will not be able to resist throwing me my pitch. Before Lance approached the batter's box, I said to him, the guy in left field is expecting you to hit it high and long. Hit it high and short into left field. He won't be able to adjust his position in time to catch it. Lance smiled with a big grin and said, this is what I was made for. Isn't that awesome? You can almost hear Lance saying that if you know Lance. I was born to give left field problems. Let me just restate that. I was born to give the left problems. And he gives them problems. We could see the numbers on his jersey as he walked to the batter's box. And he was wearing the number 2388. Which in Hebrew, it's the number for the word that means to be or grow strong or to be strengthened. I believe God has strengthened the ecclesia by finally showing us in the last movement that we're all a part of the ecclesia. And it's not just a few. The strength that has come from that revelation is really incalculable. When that revelation came into the early church, when the signs and wonders and the preaching was no longer being done only by the apostles, but was also being done by the members in general, the deacons began to preach and heal the sick, Stephen, Philip, and others. When that started happening, the wording in the book of Acts changed from addition to multiplication. When describing the growth of the church, the first five or six chapters, I think it's five, the first five chapters of the book of Acts says on more than one occasion the Lord was adding to the church daily. Once the ministry started taking place by the believers in general, not just the apostles, the word changed immediately and never went back to addition. It was always the Greek word for multiply. So the success and the salvations of the church went from addition to multiplication when believers in general realized we're anointed to do this too, not just the apostles. So that's what I think his number represents. Just before the pitcher released the ball, Gabriel gave the guy on first base the sign to steal. He shot from first and stole second. The pitch landed just in front of home plate. The umpire called it a strike. Lance looked at me in the dugout for waiting for me to protest the call. I came out of the dugout very quickly and proceeded toward the umpire with fire in my eyes and pointed my finger at the umpire and declared, let me just stop here before I tell you what I declared. Because I believe, for me, because of what I've heard and the way I think about the Supreme Court justices, I believe that the umpires represent, in the dream, the judicial system. The number one thing they like to say is, we don't make the rules, we're just umpires. We just rule based on the laws or the rules somebody else makes. So we're not the players, we're just umpires. We don't play the game. We don't make the rules. We just rule, call the shots based on what somebody else does and the laws they made. Now, they don't always do that, but that's what they like to say. And some of them do. Some of them do try to do that. So I went to that umpire and I said, you will reverse this call and give it back. You do not have the authority to change the strike zone. The umpire reversed the call immediately. I could tell in the dream that it weakened his authority on the field when Dutch addressed him this way. We became convinced that the reversing of the call was the reversing of Roe by the umpire, the court. So for 3 months, I've been waiting to see if in the second quarter of the year they have to reverse the call. And we made it. We made it. We made it. Reversed it. Against all odds. And to get a dream this specific and close is amazing. So we'll get to the third quarter of the year in a minute. Before stepping back into the batter's box, Lance looked at the pitcher and said, you don't have the nerve to throw me my pitch. You don't have the ability to cause me to miss it. Throw that cutter, and I'll hit it. You could see the anger, pride on the pitcher's face. He drew back and threw Lance his pitch. He threw it hard and fast. Lance hit it high and shallow in the left field. just like we planned. The left fielder called it, which stopped any of his other teammates from advancing toward the ball. When they call it, for those of you that don't follow baseball, that means if a player says, I got it, everybody else gets out of the way so they don't run into each other. So the left fielder called it, I got it, which stopped any of his other teammates from advancing toward the ball. The left fielder ran forward for the ball, and as he did this, he was watching the spin Lance had put on the ball. This confused him. Confusion came to the enemy, which caused him to trip, which caused him to miss the ball. When he fell, he dislocated both of his knees and couldn't get back up. He easily made it to first base, and the other fellow stayed on second. I want to say this to you. A great dislocation. An incredibly huge dislocation has just occurred in the enemy's camp. Even though this does not outlaw or make abortion illegal, most of you in here are informed enough to know it just sends it to the states, and they will decide state by state what they're going to do. But what it does do is reverses a law, changes a decree, the decree of a nation, and the government of a nation, which gave Satan, I would say, there probably could not have been anything that would have given him greater authority to operate in our nation than a legal decree that it's now legal to shed the blood of the innocent babies. The shedding of innocent blood brings a curse on the land. And it has fed the spirit of Baal. It has, the blood sacrifices has fed the strong man over America for 50 years. If we don't hate abortion providers, we certainly have no condemnation for people that have had an abortion. There's cleansing, there's forgiveness. If you ever participated in that, it's under the blood of Jesus. God does not remember it. Hold it to your account. You don't have to remember it either. I have a message I preach. I give it away free on my website. Broken No More. A strong revelation for people that will help completely free and heal individuals that still experience the shame and the any guilt or condemnation from having been a part of that. That's not what this is about. This is about dealing with the strong man spiritually over our nation who has just been brought to his knees. This is why there's such anger. This is why these spirits are motivating such rage, because they are bloodthirsty. And to see this hold broken and this legal decree reversed, which I know Jane talked about, but to see that reversed now enables the Lord to do some things for the nation, which we'll get to the states, which he could not do until this happened. So cut the head off of the religious spirit in the first quarter, and we reversed the evil call and decree of the umpire in the second quarter. Dutch then called from the dugout, "Hammond, You're up. Girls can play baseball, but not with the guys, really, just in dreams. Okay. Well, unless it's just like backyard, you can, then you can play that. But not, we don't know. The World Sears Series, we want all the Hammonds we can get. Jane Hammond took a bat in her hand and stepped from the dugout. And I said to her, they will position themselves at the wall, that being the home run fence of the wall out there, because they know you can break the home run record with one swing of your bat. So evidently you had been doing really well, Jane, in this, and your bat at your record. I would say, I don't know, I don't want to make too much of this, but maybe it means you're really doing a good job in your accuracy of hitting home runs, telling us what God's saying. And we are grateful, not only for you, but your whole clan. So they'll position themselves at the wall because they know one swing of your bat, you can break the home run record. So I believe you should bunt towards third. She replied, that's exactly what I was thinking. I've noticed that he, being the third baseman, does not have the rapidness in his eyes that he thinks he has. As Jane stood in the batter's box, we once again could see the number on her jersey, 4851. It's amazing how these dreams work, isn't it? It's a Greek word that means sumphero, means to bring together. It is the word in John 16 when Jesus said, it is to your advantage that I leave, because if I do, Holy Spirit can come. So the word It is a word for advantage, even though it means bring together, because the word pictures the advantage that is created when two or more come together and work together. So Jesus chose that word and said, when Holy Spirit comes or joins you, it's going to create the advantage, the coming together, which produces an advantage that you need. Because I've been with you, but he'll be in you. That's what he was saying. So it's not surprising to me that with the anointing that Jane carries, being such a strong prophetic anointing, that this would be a number that pictures Holy Spirit coming to us to give us the advantage. Now, obviously, we have not experienced the third quarter yet of the year. I'm pressing in now, starting tonight, asking the Lord, or telling the Lord and then asking, that you showed us what the first quarter of the year was all about, and you helped us accomplish that. You showed us what the second three-month period was all about. And incredibly, we got to second. Now, what does this mean, this emphasis on Holy Spirit in this next three-month segment? I tell you what I think. I'm not ready to say yet, I know. I think the Holy Spirit outpouring that we have been talking about, prophesying, that we know is coming at a much greater level the turning up of the revival, the awakening that's beginning, I think goes to another level over the summer months. July, August, September, I'm looking for outpourings of Holy Spirit to break out all across our nation. I'm open to what the other prophets here are experiencing, thinking about that, but that's what I'm feeling during the worship. So, but anyway, I said, Bunt, don't go for the fence. She said, that's exactly what I was thinking. He doesn't have the sharpness that he thinks he has. So Jane stood in the batter's box. We once again could see the number. I already read that, 48-51. Advantage, Holy Spirit, okay. The pitcher mocked her. Demons do not like prophets. He mocked her as she stood there waiting for the pitch. He threw a fastball high and just outside the corner of the plate, missing the strike zone. Jane stood still. She never even twitched. Seeing this, Gabriel looked at the runner on second and gave him the signal to steal third as soon as the pitcher started his next windup. The pitcher drew back his arm, and as soon as he did, the guy left second base. The person that had been freed from the religious spirit was a part of a denomination that is going to get slammed by Holy Spirit in the coming outpouring. Left second, and it was almost as if he just appeared on third. He was just translated. There he was. This confused the pitcher. As he caught this out of the corner of his eye, he released the ball, and it came to the plate again, this time low and just outside the strike zone. I left the dugout, motioned to Jane to come over, leaned into her ear and said, let the next two pitches go through. No swinging at what he's throwing. This will give us the strategy we need to win this. Some thought, the Dutch was thinking the pitcher was done, didn't have any more energy or strength, and didn't have any more strikes in his arm. So they were thinking, some thought I was saying this to her and thinking he's going to walk you. Jane stepped back into the batter's box and did as Dutch had coached her to do. The next pitch came hard and fast. Strike one, the umpire shouted and then laughed. Second pitch came as a changeup pitch, very slow. Strike two. Jane stepped down on the batter's box and took a deep breath and looked back at me, at the coach. Dutch motioned Jane back to where he was standing and said, it's two and two. Count is two and two. We're in the right place to bunt it down the third baseline. She approached the plate again, positioned herself. The pitcher released a curveball. Jane stepped into it and bunted it down the third base line. It caught the third baseman off guard. No one had ever bunted on this pitch before. He moved very slowly, retrieved the ball. He held it in fear that the guy on third would advance to home plate if he tried to throw it to the first baseman. Lance easily moved to second. Jane took first. Now the bases were loaded. Maybe, just maybe, over the summer, Holy Spirit's going to load the bases. Maybe he's setting the stage for 2022 to be the year of breakthrough. The coach catcher from the other team went out to the pitcher's mound and began speaking with the pitcher. In the dream, we could tell there was disagreement among them. It even seemed that the pitcher had authority over the coach. of the other team. As we were watching this, a phone rang in our dugout. Dutch answered it, and we could see him looking up and behind home plate into one of the sky boxes, talking to someone there on the phone. Wonder what the sky box pictures. Heaven, okay. Headquarters, the team owner. He was speaking to the team owner. The owner of the team said, "You're going to pinch hit to me." If you don't know baseball, that means the guy that was going to bat, the person is not going to bat, somebody else is going to bat. Called a pinch hitter. "You're going to pinch hit. We have a wicket or an opening or an opportunity here to not only win the game, but to win big." So now this will be the fourth quarter, by the way, the fourth batter. He went on to say, "Dutch, you know this pitcher. He's lost some big games before. He's not what he makes himself out to be. Be patient. Don't be distracted at what he throws at you. He wants to get your eyes off of the pennant. Pennant is what they call the when you win the series or you win your division, it's called winning the pennant. They call it that because a pennant, you know, it's shaped like that. That's just what it, when baseball started, the winner would get a pennant. So they call it winning the pennant. They still call it winning the pennant. I don't know if you wanted that, if that's TMI, but you got it, all right? He wants you to get your eyes off of the pennant. In other words, he wants you to get your eyes off the game, off the prize. He wants to distract you. Dutch hung up the phone and said, "Hood, hand me my bat. I've been instructed to pinch hit." Greg said, "I reached for Dutch's bat, pulled it from a large wooden communion box." Isn't that interesting? Covenant, communion, the blood and the wine. "I pulled it from a large wooden communion box it was locked away in. The secret, the bat, what was going to be needed to win this game was found in covenant. The new covenant in Christ's blood and our honoring of that covenant." I don't know how you can put enough emphasis on that. "As I removed it," this is him talking, "as he removed it," he said, "he had the dream. As I removed it in the dream, I could see clearly that the bat had inscribed on it Ephesians 1:17. I pray that you receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation," Paul said. Amazing. "I handed it to Dutch, who said to me," I asked Greg, "what direction should I launch the ball?" This is something I don't want to get too bogged down in details, but Greg, even though he has apostolic anointing, his strongest gift would be that of a prophet. Even though I'm prophetic, my stronger gift would be that of an apostle. Here are two, an apostle and a prophet, working together, which is going to be key to knowing what we need to know to win the game. It's the harmony, it's the cooperation of the ministry gifts working together. I love working with these people. I love it when they take the ball and run with it. There's no competition. Those I run with, we just work together. It's a beautiful thing. It's the way God intended it to be. It's There's no one trying to be the big star. There's no one trying to gain control. It's just whatever, however the Lord wants to do it, just fine with us. What direction should I launch the ball? I said. He said to me, straight for the throat of the pitcher. Now listen, listen. He said, straight for the throat of the pitcher, remove his voice. Remove his voice. I said, well, you know, many will think it's a dirty and illegal move on our part. But what the heck? We won't allow them to force us to play by their rules anymore. We play for the Royals. As Dutch walked toward the batter's box, Greg said to me, if you hit the mark, it will change the game. The pitcher approached the batter's box as Dutch stepped into it and said, I'm here to take you and this weak team out once and for all. That's not what I said. That's what the pitcher said to me. The pitcher approached the batter's box as I stepped into it and said to me, I'm here to take you and this weak team out once and for all. You have no hope of making it out of this batter's box in your right mind. This is my season, and you will not steal it from me. Dutch stepped up to him, just an inch from his face, and spoke with a firm and bold voice. I am here to uncover you. Now go back to your perch and throw the ball. As he walked back to the pitcher's mound, we could see the name on the back of his jersey. It's the first time in the dream it reveals the name of the pitcher. Written on the back of the jersey was the name Zephon, Zephon. One of the names of Baal is Baal Zephon. Zephon was the god considered the strongest of the god. There was a group of names and spirits in the Baal structure. This is the last of the Baal gods, little g, that the Lord exposed in the deliverance of Israel from Egypt. All of the plagues were exposing the fact that they all represented one of these gods, the Baal structure, the gods of Egypt. And each one, Yahweh, was showing Israel and Egypt that these gods are not gods at all. They're just idols. I am God of the hail and the winds and the rain and the crops and the harvest. No. This was considered the strongest, because this was the god of the wind and the god of the winter and the god of the seas. And his strong high place where they had built him a monument was at the point of the Red Sea where Israel crossed. Exodus 14. Pharaoh, this is what the Jews teach, Pharaoh thought because Israel went past that point And then it looked like they got confused. If you go back and read it, God said to Moses, turn around and go back to this spot right here. So even though they'd been in their departure past there, they came back, made a circle, came back to this spot, which hemmed them in by the sea and the mountains and the army of Pharaoh. Now they were trapped. So what Pharaoh thought, and this is what, again, this is what the Jews teach, what Pharaoh thought was they got Zaphon confused them and brought them into a trap. And he thought, finally, one of my gods that is greater than Yahweh. He's outsmarted their God. God, however, was about to deal the final blow to this Baal system and show them Zaphon is not the god of the sea and the wind. I am. So he trapped Pharaoh in the sea with the wind and destroyed the army of Pharaoh in front of the Zaphon god that they thought was over the wind in the sea. Last year, God started speaking to some of the prophets about finishing the breaking of the hold of Baal, the strong man over America, and he began to, before we ever had this dream, he began to focus us in our prayers and decrees and studies on Baal Zaphon. And he started to say to some of these prophets, and I felt it too, I said it as well, just as he did when he delivered Israel, when it's going to look like his people are trapped and the enemy has won, God is going to show himself strong and drown the armies of Pharaoh and deliver his people. So when I saw in the dream the name of this picture, I knew God was saying, this is Baal, the strong man that has ruled this nation for decades. God showed me that in 2007, that Baal was the strong man. That's what the call 777 was all about, divorcing Baal and recovenanting with the Lord. So, the pitcher, the strong man, was Baal, Zaphon. He released his first pitch, and it was not aimed anywhere close to home plate. It went over the stadium wall behind home plate, hit a bus parked in the parking lot. Put a large dent in the back left side of the bus. An alarm sounded with a very distinct sound. We knew this was our team's bus. The umpire said, strike one. I think it's going to get more obvious. God's going to continue exposing people in government, how crooked and deceitful and deceived they are. The coach came to the pitcher's mound again and brought the pitcher Zaphon another baseball glove. It was a left-hander's glove and an old greasy-looking ball. He had been pitching right-handed the entire game up to now. He went in his windup, released the ball. It flew into the dugout, hit one of the coaches in the temple. The umpire shouted, strike two. The umpire spoke to the pitcher, you only have one strike left. The person in the dugout got back up as though they had never been hit. It was at this point in the dream that we noticed the umpire was wearing a white doctor's type coat that had the insignia of a pharmacist on it. Pharmakia, spirit of witchcraft. Doesn't mean pharmacists are all into witchcraft. It's one of the words for witchcraft in the New Testament is pharmakia. they do the same thing to a person that drugs do to a person. You find it in Revelation 23:18, where it talks about the spirit of Babylon that had confused the nations. That's pharmakia. I turned to the umpire and said, "You are no longer allowed to call this game. We remove you, and Michael will take your place." I then turned to the pitcher and said, "Throw your ball. It's the last pitch for you, but not my last ball. I will deliver the third strike to you and your house." Zephon threw the ball. I hit it with a powerful swing. The ball went to its mark and struck the throat of the pitcher, Zephon, taking his voice and his strength. Zephon was removed from the game. We knew in the dream the game had changed. This pitcher would never pitch again. I'm going to ask you guys to come up here and pray with me and decree or prophesy whatever God's given you about this. We're moving into the third quarter of the year, where Holy Spirit, the advantage from Holy Spirit comes to us through perhaps primarily the prophets. At least he's saying to us, it will be through hearing the word of the Lord. And it will be because of the power of Holy Spirit. He will show us what to do if there's a part for us to play, what we need to do to tap into that victory in the third quarter. He will show us. If he hasn't already shown somebody, he will show us. Just like he did the religious spirit and the abortion thing. And by the end of this year, he's saying to us, you can have the stronghold of this spirit that has ruled America for 50 years. You can have this broken off of you once and for all. He will have no more voice in this nation. And I'm sure there will be specific assignments toward that. He will show us what to do. So let me start praying, and you guys can just... You don't have to come up here. You're welcome to come up here. What? Because of the sound? Well, then just come on up here while I pray. You guys that are part of the leadership team, anybody? We'll just jump in. We'll prophesy into this. We'll pray into this. Lord, I thank you for what you have done today in this nation. We know the battle isn't over. But we know a decree, a law, a decree that has held this nation in captivity for 50 years was reversed. The umpires were forced to change the call. We know that the root of a religious spirit that has controlled millions of people in our nation has been broken, and they will now be released to move into a relationship with Holy Spirit they've never had. We thank you for the incredible benefit of Holy Spirit that will come now to the forefront in this next three-month season. And I believe, Holy Spirit, you're going to be poured out. I believe you're just about to say, okay, it's my time to step in to the batter's box here. And I'm going to take over this game. Our confidence is in you, not ourselves. We know you could knock it clear out of the park, or you can bunt it and take them up by surprise. Whatever you choose to do, fine. You're going to advance the runners. You're going to give us breakthrough. You are our advantage. And we look to you. And you are going to show us by the end of this year what we need to do to break the hold of this Baal structure off of America. And return to you, Yahweh, as our God. Now, Lord, show us what needs to happen. Speak by your Spirit here and out from this meeting through prophets, leaders, intercessors. Show us what we need to know and understand to take this game, this seer series forward. And we believe and know that you will, in Jesus' name. I don't know who's next. So I'm going to just jump in.
I just have a little piece of it right now is that I think it was about maybe 2 weeks ago. I was at Fresh Start Church with Kim Owens, Paul and Kim Owens, in Arizona, a place that's been sustaining revival for the last 7 years. And I really felt like when I was there that we needed to marry together the apostolic and prophetic movement with the spirit of revival. And so we did a prophetic act while we were there, and I think it's really kind of pointing to this third quarter that we're coming into. And then we came home, and at our house, which was really the birthplace of the modern prophetic movement, we married ourselves to the spirit of awakening and revival. And so I believe that there really is another level of Holy Spirit outpouring that God wants to bring to us. And I think we all need to stand on our feet and lift up our hands. And I believe that we need to just begin to pray in the Holy Spirit. And we need to stir our spirit man up right now. You know, a lot of people, when they receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. How many of you have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit in a previous season, okay? Most charismatic Pentecostals have come in and have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and really we're looking for one thing, and that was for the gift of your prayer language, the gift of tongues. But do you realize that that's not all we were supposed to have gotten? We were supposed to have received dunamis power. We were supposed to have received revelation. We were supposed to have received the love of God shed abroad in our heart. We were supposed to have received faith and miracles. And so all over this place, I want us to lift up our hands, and I want us to pray in the Holy Ghost. And I feel like tonight, just as a signifier that we're stepping into this new outpouring of the mantle of the Holy Spirit, I just hear the Lord saying, I want to rebaptize you tonight in the Holy Spirit. I want to rebaptize you so that the ecclesia can have everything it needs to move into this new season. So lift your hands and begin to pray in tongues. I want to hear you praying in tongues. Come on, I want to hear it. I want to hear it louder. I want to hear you stir it up right now. Shikata rababakata. Come on, out of your belly will flow. Out of your belly will flow. Lord, we stir up that Holy Spirit power right now, God. We stir up the mantle of dunamis. We stir up the mantle of revelation, oh God. We stir up, Father God, that power, Lord God, that spirit of wisdom and revelation. We stir it up right now, Father God, the love of God that's shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost right now tonight, Father God. Lord, we as the ecclesia, we not only marry ourselves to the apostolic and the prophetic anointings, but God, we marry ourselves to Pentecostal fire. We marry ourselves, oh God, to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We marry ourselves, Father God, God, to a passionate pursuit of you, oh God, and for a harvester's anointing, God, to see a harvest come in. God, the harvest is ripe, but Lord, we've got to be the harvesters. So Lord, we stir ourselves up tonight. We activate it tonight, oh God. Let there be an outpouring that touches every denominational church, that touches every charismatic church, that touches every Pentecostal church, that touches every church that's been apostolic and prophetic, and shift us in to a full revival anointing, Father, in this third quarter. We decree it tonight in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. Come on, just keep praying in the Spirit. The Lord would say, I am about ready to meet together with you, nation. It is a new season that you're entering into. And you will know that you have met your God. And I will release the power and the strength of all of my nature into this nation. I am about to baptize you anew. I am about to sweep over you with a wind that will cause a shaking in the ground, a shaking in the atmosphere, where everyone will fall to their knees and tremble. I am meeting with you, says God. I just, part of the revelation that I was getting with this, and it's, I think it's tied in with Jane in this new season, because it's the number was 48551, and you said it's to bring together, but it also to be profitable, but also to bring together. And there is a bringing together. You just talked about bringing it together. The apostles and the prophets, the ecclesia coming back into a new unity. But what I kept on hearing, it's tied in with another dream. I think all these dreams, they're mysteriously tied together, Dutch. And the one that just I can't get rid of, and you know it, I've been stirred with it, is the Liberty Bell. Greg had that one as well. And in the Liberty Bell, it's going to be retuned to 528. And in the Greek, 528 means to meet face to face. And there's something there as the Liberty Bell is retuned and refashioned, that there's going to be a sound that is released of the Spirit of God. And it goes, you may want to speak into this, because the Lord said, we are now moving into a new season for America. Well, they will determine by the Spirit of God that we are dependent only on Him. And that's everything the Lord's been putting into you, Clay. So, Lord, we are saying tonight, we are hearing a retuning of who we are as a nation. We are hearing a new sound. There will be a jubilee sound coming from the Liberty Bell that wipes away all of the false structures of the past. There will not be any crack in this bell. It will not be destroyed. It will ring clearly a new sound into the nation that everyone will hear, and it will release the power of my Spirit over the nation. It will sound freedom and liberty. In Jesus' name, it will come forth.
Father, we stand here tonight. And we openly declare our dependency upon you. For you are the God that answers by fire. And we serve you, notice, Bell. You can turn up your noise. You can bring forth your violence. You can bring forth intimidation. But we serve the God that answers by fire. And tonight we step into the counsel of the Lord and we call down fire in this nation. We call down the fire of revival. We call down the fire of justice. We call down the fire of empowering grace. We call down the fire of apostolic and prophetic decrees. We declare the streams are coming together and there is a city of God that is being made glad. We declare that division is going to be removed from the ecclesia. We declare that there is a voice that is speaking, and it is from the God that answers by fire. And tonight, Baal, we serve you notice. Those that have done your bidding are being cut off. We speak to the George Soros and those that he supports, and we cut you off this night. We speak to the Clintons and their agenda for this nation, and we cut you off tonight. We speak to those that are shouting into the ear of Biden, and we declare we cut you off tonight. We declare the money flow will dry up and their influence will come to be naught. We declare that the ecclesia is moving out of the valley of decision, and our yes will be yes and our no will be no, and we set our faces like foreheads of flint, and we declare that iron is sharpening iron. We declare that our declarations and decrees shall be heard from border to border and from coast to coast. We declare that there is a sound that's being released, a sound of fervency, a sound of praying, the prayers that God is giving and putting in our heart. We declare that our decrees will establish a new era. It established this new season. It established a movement of God that will shake things across this nation. Let your power be released. We declare that even out of the baptism of Holy Spirit, we're moving from it being an experience into a release of dunamis power. We declare that the endowment of power shall become made manifest. We declare that the dead will be raised and it will hit national papers about the raising of the dead. We declare that unusual miracles will be advertised in papers which have spoken against the ecclesia, which has spoken against God. We declare that they will become so prevalent that they will be written up. We declare, Holy Ghost, empowered evangelists will not only go and bring people into Christ, but they will be discipled. And we declare, where it is taking some of us 40 years to get to where we're going, Lord, you're going to bring forth an exponential increase, and what we've taken 40 years to accomplish, they will accomplish in 4 years. We declare that. Bring them forth. Bring them forth. Let revelation ring across this nation. Give a spiritual understanding of where to be, when we're to be, and not in any way question the cost of being there. And Father, we declare out of the prophetic word that said, when this false altar comes down, that it will be the tipping point of the other false altars. So, Father, I see a chain reaction. 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 I see. Father, we declare divine reversal. Everybody say this with me. Divine reversal. Divine reversal. Divine reversal. Divine reversal. Divine reversal. divine reversal. Father, we speak and call in the wealth transfer. I prophesy over the apostolic movement in this nation. Heaven is open, and you're pouring out blessings we cannot even contain. Father, move on the heart of businessmen and women that have been straddling the fence. And Father, we ask forgiveness. We ask forgiveness for some of the charismatic foolishness that's pushed away the business people. Father, give us greater wisdom of how to walk this out. But Father, we thank you out of attitude. We thank you out of attitude for the wealth that's coming. We thank you, Father. Father, we representing the ecclesia, we don't need things. But Father, we need the finances to be able to do, to be totally obedient to you. So we call in from the north, the south, the east, and the west, billionaires that will write checks. And Father, we make a covenant with you today. We will steward it properly. It won't be about how it can benefit us. It'll be about benefiting the mandate that you've given to each of us. So, Father, we call in that wealth transfer. And Lord, I just decree that it's time to put Ishmael out of the house. It's time to send Ishmael forth, Father. We declare the flesh will no longer produce in the apostolic movement in this nation. So we speak to you, Ishmael, and we tell you go. We tell you to leave the house that God is establishing, the lineage that God is establishing through Abraham and through Isaac. And we declare an increase of disciples in the body of Christ.
Let me say this, is that, you know, I was just telling Dutch that probably over the last 2 weeks, we've probably led over 200 people in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. In meetings like this, people that have registered and paid money to come to meetings like this that aren't even filled with the Holy Spirit. There may be some of you here tonight. But there's been a shift in the Spirit. People are so hungry. We're going to come into something that's greater than the outpouring of the charismatic renewal. God's going to start pouring His Spirit out on a lot of the churches, the denominational churches, people that are, because that religious spirit's been broken. Come on, that religious spirit's now been broken. And it's time for a fresh outpouring. And it's not just going to be a repeat and a rinse and repeat of all of these meetings. It's going to be a whole new harvest that's coming in that's creating harvesters. And I heard the Lord give a warning to the prophets in that third quarter. And here was the warning. If I represent the prophetic movement, here was the warning that Dutch gave to me. Don't swing at what Baal pitches. And I think the prophets need to hear that we need to hear from heaven, and we don't need to be reactionary in our prophecies. We need to be hearing from heaven and prophesying what God is saying, not reacting to what the enemy is saying. Because as much as I believe this is going to be a time of tremendous outpouring, I believe that the next 3 months are going to be a time of tremendous upheaval, tremendous tension. Come on. Come on. How many have been believing for turnaround in this nation? Do you think that it was going to just be pretty and easy? I'm telling you, we're coming into the 3 months that's going to be a tipping point moment, and we must have the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and we must have the release of the Holy Spirit, but the prophet's words must be pure words. They must be pure words, and we cannot be prophesying out of either a political spirit or a self-motivated spirit or a look-at-me spirit. Come on. That's right. That's right. Yeah, we got to go for the fence. You know, no, we've got to be humble. That's what a bunt is. A bunt is humble. Can you understand what the Lord's saying, prophets? We've got to be willing to not go for this big, splashy, showy words. We've got to be willing to take the bunt and not be reactionary. Let's lift up our hands, because every single one of us are going to hear from heaven. Come on, we decree a fresh outpouring of the prophetic right now. And the Spirit of the Lord says that I am pouring out my Spirit in this day upon all flesh. And I am pouring it out on Methodists and Baptists and Catholic and Lutheran and Episcopal and Charismatic and Seeker Friendly and Pentecostal. I'm pouring it out on my body, but I'm going to start pouring it out on the world too, says the Lord. And they're going to start having prophetic dreams and prophetic visions. And the Lord says, I'm warning my prophets. I'm setting my prophets on notice. Let your words be pure words. Let your words be words that hit the mark. For the Lord says, as you do that, as you take that humble position and prophesy by my Spirit, the Lord said, it will be that that drives confusion into the camp of the enemy. It will be that that drives confusion into that third basement, says the Lord, and it will position that for the home run, the cleaning of the bases in the next season. But the Lord says, you can't go for glory, prophets. You got to stay low. So, Lord, we thank you, Father God, for pure Holy Spirit. We thank you, God, for pure prophetic. And for the marriage between apostles and prophets in the spirit of revival, we decree that marriage now. And Lord, we decree that this is a Mount Carmel moment, Father God. This is a Mount Carmel where the prophets of Baal in the media and the prophets of Baal in politics, come on, they're the mouthpiece of Baal, the prophets of Baal. That, Lord, that you are going to expose them. Lord, today they're cutting themselves as a blood oath sacrifice to make up for the blood that's being lost on the altars of abortion. They're cutting themselves in front of cameras, God, with their words. And we decree, God, that you didn't, that God did not answer by fire in the days of Elijah on Mount Carmel, but you are the true God that will answer by fire. And we decree, oh God, that you're going to answer by fire in this nation. And God, you're going to destroy the prophets of Baal. God, we've been watching it over the last several years that one by one you're taking out media kingpins, God. You're discrediting them. You're dishonoring them. You're uncovering them. But Lord, we thank you, Father God, this year is going to be spectacular in what you're going to do to deal with the prophets of Baal. God, we declare that we're on your side and you're the God that answers by fire. Come, Holy Spirit, come and answer us by fire.
When she was prophesying, I heard the Lord say, for truly Baal was divorced, but he has been in contempt of the court-ordered decrees that have come forth. But the Lord said, this night I release the angels of justice to go enforce the decrees that have come from heaven on a whole new level. For he shall not be able to resist the court orders, decrees, and the resources that he has held on to and refused to release in the last 15 years. The release is now, says the Lord.
I heard the Lord say that even in this season, and this is a word I've been carrying since last October, that even in this season where the Elis and the sons of Elis are being exposed, the skirts are being lifted up, the covers are being pulled back, know this, that I have the Samuels whose words will come forth and they will not fall to the ground. For there is a company of prophets that is rising up in the land that will be humble, that will be pure, that will partner with the apostolic. In fact, they will even identify the kings, the Davids of this generation, and will serve the Davids while they go through the battle to take the land. And I say to you, prophets, align. Apostles, align together. Come together in the unity. Come together and lay the foundation. And I heard the Lord a few moments ago. He said, in the past movements of Holy Spirit, even in the charismatic movement and in the movements of revival we have seen in days gone by, it has been about the personal enrichment. It has been about what's in it for me, what gift will get activated in me, what refreshing will I get. But the Lord says, know this, that in this time and this season, with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that I'm doing upon a restored foundation of apostles and prophets, recognizing that Jesus alone is the cornerstone, that there is going to be a movement of the Spirit of God that is going to build the house of God, and no longer will the team be mocked as weak. No longer will the team be mocked as weak. They will know that we are here with a sound out of heaven, and Holy Spirit in and through the ecclesia is going to become a restraining force in the earth to the wickedness that comes forth.
I just want to remind everyone, God is never late. God is always on time. We've heard instances all this time that we've been here, whether it's what Dutch said earlier, that it was right at the end of this second quarter of the year, but God did it. It was Jane that decreed that Esther's decree was written during this same day. When we were flying into Atlanta, I told you this yesterday, I was listening to my daily Bible readings, Exodus 14, Baal Zephon, and the message that I gave you yesterday was, do not fear, the battle is the Lord's. You will not see these Egyptians again. But listen to me. 15 years ago this month, I was placed in over the network that oversees Texas. And I still remember shaking when I thought Chuck, there in the state capitol, that's where I was commissioned, is in the state capitol. I said, Chuck, he's going to preach tonight. This is going to be great. He commissioned me and gave me the mic and said, it's all yours. And I stood there for a while, and the Lord brought a prophetic word to me that set the tone, not only for then, but for tonight. Because we're going into the third quarter where it's going to be all dependence on God. All hearing clear prophetic revelation. And what I spoke that night was, the Lord just told me that He will use our state, Texas, to help change the nation if you'll let me deal with your two primary sins, pride and independence. So immediately we hit the floor. I'm not saying you have to hit the floor tonight, but right now, Lord, we once again say we humble ourselves. If my people, we humble ourselves, we are entering into the third quarter of a great victorious year, but we will not do it with pride or independence. So, Lord, we humble ourselves again tonight. And I say, Lord, would you please use us? Let our eyes and our ears and our hearts be open to hear, see, and perceive what you are doing. So that what we decree as the ecclesia, as the kingdom ecclesia, will indeed shift a nation and bring it back into its destiny that you designed from the very beginning. This is yours, Lord. It's all yours.
Hallelujah. Dutch, when you started the dream, you said it's for all the marbles. You said we got to win it for the nation. When he said that, I thought of my two uncles, that one went in at the beaches in Normandy and fought all the way to Berlin. One was in the Battle of the Bulge. When they asked him, how did you fight for 300 days with no R&R? How did you press through the weariness? How did a 17-year-old boy get shot at and fight all the way? You know what they said? They said, we knew we had to win. We had to win. There's no other option. There's no retreat. There's no 33rd parallel. We've got to win. I had a text while Dutch was teaching from a friend, and he said, don't put this out on social media. They don't want anybody to know. They don't have protection. The CPC that she oversees can't get security to work for them. And they called the police, and the police said, you're on your own. We won't come. We got to win this thing. And I'm going to pray. She said, pray for the CPCs, the crisis pregnancy centers across this nation. And tonight, Lord God, we lift them up to you. We thank you that angels go to war on our behalf. We thank you that chariots of fire from heaven surround those crisis pregnancy centers, surround those places that help young ladies, women with babies that are going to have babies. We thank you. They look like this angel on the wall over here. They have fire and they have swords. And they're mighty in God. And we thank you there's no devil in hell can penetrate their protection. And we thank you, Lord, because of the armies of heaven, we are going to win this thing. We're going to press through. And we're going to win it in Jesus' name. Amen.
I know where to go in the morning. I feel like we're at a good place. We're hearing. I believe I'm finished. I think it's appropriate to just hand it to Jane, let her do what the Lord's leading her to do to end the service.
Amen. So I think that as a prophetic act, I think we should pray for anybody that is not filled with the Holy Spirit. If you're here tonight, is there anybody here tonight? You're not, you don't have the fullness of the Holy Spirit. You don't speak in tongues yet. You want to receive that? Anybody here tonight? I know you're looking around the room, but are there people here that you've not yet received? In Ephesians chapter 19, we heard it this morning. They said, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? They said, we didn't even know there was a Holy Spirit. Okay? And so he said, were you baptized into the baptism of repentance with John? And then he called for them, and he said, he laid hands on them, and he said, receive the Holy Spirit. And they began to speak in tongues and prophesy. That's the outpouring and the prophetic right there, married together. So is there anybody here at all? Just lift your hand up. I think so. Just come on down here real quick. Thank you. There's several people. Come on down here. There's several people. And if you're here and you don't have the fullness of the Holy Spirit, you don't have a good flow in your prayer language, you've got to have that for this next season. I want you to come on down. Come on, this is awesome. Come on, we're going to wait because some of you are still considering it. I want you just to know, some of you say, oh, I've been prayed for a bunch of times. I'm telling you, we're in a totally different season. You're going to get filled tonight, I'm telling you. Come on, all the way down here, all the way across the front. I want people all the way across the front, amen. Hallelujah, they're still coming. That this is a beautiful picture of what's happening today is that you guys registered for a crazy conference like this with the ecclesia, and you don't yet have the fullness of the Holy Spirit. I don't know if that's what you came expecting to get, but I'm telling you, that's what you're going to get. All right? So let me just make sure, are every single one of you born again? Nod your head at me. If you know for sure, absolutely no doubt whatsoever that you're born again. Okay. So then you are the candidates Ephesians 19 was talking about that you believed, right? And you're born again as well. Come on, we got one last call. Come on up. There's more people. Several more people. Come on up. Yeah, come on up. I just suddenly heard the Holy Spirit say, wait a minute, there's a few more. Come on down. I'm going to need some help up here with some leaders that know how to pray people through the Holy Ghost. So here's what we're going to do. They're still coming. Isn't this awesome? Isn't this awesome? So what we're going to do is I'm going to go down the line, and I just need leaders to come and stand behind each one of these people, and then I'm going to lay hands on them, and I'm going to say, receive the Holy Spirit. When I say that, you're going to take a deep breath, because the word breath and the word spirit are the same word in the Greek, okay? You're going to take a deep breath. You're going to breathe in. You're going to open your mouth, and then you are going to begin to speak out. Paul said, I will pray in the spirit. I'll pray in English. I will pray. So by an act of your will, you're going to open your mouth. You're going to begin to speak in a language that doesn't come from your head. You realize that they say that they put people in an MRI machine and they've checked what happens in their brain. Because somebody here needs to hear this. What happens in the brain when somebody prays in tongues? They have them pray in English first and they watch the language center of the brain light up. Come on up here. Yeah, come on. They watch the language center of the brain light up the way that it's supposed to, and then they say, now switch into praying in tongues. And you know what happens? The language center in the brain goes quiet, and a part of the brain that doesn't light up any other time starts lighting up in the brain. It's because it doesn't come out of your language center. It comes out of your spirit. All right? So how many of you are ready? I want you to lift your hands up all over this place. And I want everybody else to stand up with us. And again, we're going to get refilled with the Holy Ghost. So I want you to pray in tongues. I'm going to challenge all of you to start praying in tongues more. You're barely scratching the surface. So we're going to fill this atmosphere with the sound of the Holy Spirit. So Father, we thank you right now, God. We say, receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. Take a deep breath. Open your mouth. Right now, receive. That's right. That's right. Receive the Holy Spirit. Take a deep breath. Y'all come around to the front. Receive the Holy Spirit. That's it. 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 Come on, you don't have to wait for me. Receive the Holy Ghost. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. Gotta come up here and get in her ear. Receive the Holy Ghost. Take a deep breath. Can take a deep breath. Open your mouth. Right now, receive. Pick her back up. Pick her back up. Right now, pick her back up. Right now, receive the Holy Ghost. That's it. Speak it out. Speak it out. Be filled with power. Be filled with revelation. Right now, deep breath. Receive the Holy Spirit. No, keep praying with her. That's it. That's it. Receive. 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 That's it. That's it. That's it. Receive the Holy Ghost. Open your mouth. That's it. Power. Fire. 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 Receive the Holy Ghost. Lord, baptize this young evangelist. Baptize him with fire. Speak it out. Signs, wonders, miracles. I decree it now in Jesus' name. Receive the Holy Ghost. Receive. Deep breath. Now begin to speak. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. 100% of them receive. Come on, let's press in. Come on, hallelujah. Woo! Can we just give the Lord one more shout?
Hallelujah! 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 The best is yet to come. You've walked in faithfulness. You have moved by faith. Now you're going to move by power. The Lord says it's a shift. It's a shift. It's a divine shift. It's a divine shift for every one of you. Stir it up. Don't let it go quiet. Don't be afraid. I'm going to tell you my story of when I got filled with the Holy Spirit. I was a Southern Baptist girl, never heard anybody speak in tongues. I was almost 31 years old. had never heard. In fact, I was forbidden to go to church with my best friend who was Pentecostal holiness because they spoke in tongues. And I'm sitting alone in my living room with my Bible on one knee and my journal on the other, as I did every day. And suddenly I began speaking in tongues. And I wrote in my journal, "Oh no, now what?" And I went on a journey of faith building, defeating the lies that have been told to me all my life. And I believe some of you have heard those lies, that it wasn't for today. I loose over you the strength to stand and to keep moving in the Holy Spirit. Let the fullness of the Holy Spirit overtake you. Activate intentionally. And I release all of the rest of you. Move in the power of the Holy Spirit. Pray in the Spirit. I agree with Jane. Pray in the Spirit more. More, more. We will see you all in the morning. We start at 9:30. We'll open the doors at 9. Y'all have a great evening. Sleep fast, dream with God, and love on somebody on your way out. God bless.